Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to Thompson Bowling Arena and a very special day in the University of Tennessee's history. I'm Bob Kessling of the Vol Network. Glad you're here to share this special moment as we welcome a new Vice Chancellor and Director of Athletics, John Curry, back to Tennessee to take over as our Athletics Director. To make the formal introduction, please welcome our Chancellor, Dr. Beverly Davenport.
Well, welcome, welcome, welcome. What a day. Today marks my second week, my 10th day as the Chancellor of the University of Tennessee's flagship campus. I want to thank the System President, Joe DiPietro, for your confidence and your trust in me, and of course, the Board of Trustees. I am prouder every day to be leading this great university. Our students, our faculty, our staff, you have been so very, very welcoming. I just am overwhelmed every day of the support that I've been receiving, and I thank all of you for what you have been doing to help me get acclimated to this city and certainly to the university. I get it. The University of Tennessee certainly is truly a special place. I also want to thank Dave Hart for his leadership as our athletic director for the past 5 years. He's been a great source of support for me even before I came, and certainly since I've arrived, every day since I've been here. If Dave is here, I want to thank him for all he's done for UT Athletics. I don't know if Dave is here, but I certainly want to extend my thank you to him. I knew when I accepted this position that finding a new athletics director was my first priority. That was clear. To say that there has been some interest in who I was going to hire or who I should hire might be quite an understatement. But our goal has never changed. We wanted the best athletic director for the University of Tennessee. And from the beginning, people asked me what I was looking for. And those of you who have heard me know that I have stood fast about that. I continue to say I wanted a sitting AD at a Power 5 school. These are complex jobs. Experience matters. I wanted someone with unwavering integrity, a commitment to compliance, a person rise. And of course, someone who's committed to winning. It is the University of Tennessee. Yes, we moved quickly, but we moved thoroughly and we moved efficiently. And that is in part to the people who served me, who recommended to me, and who helped me through the process. Those people were, in part, the search consultants, Turnkey Sports and Entertainment. Jean DiFilippo and Lynn Turner were the consummate professionals. They worked tirelessly, they partnered with us, they worked with the search committee. And I want to acknowledge, before I go any further, the members of our search committee who worked throughout this process to bring forward the very best candidates. Don Bruce, our faculty representative to the SEC and the NCAA. I don't know if our search committee members are here, but let me just call their names. Donna Thomas, our senior associate athletics director. Peyton Manning, who I think needs no introduction, and we're so proud of Peyton Manning. He's here with us today, and thank you so much for being here. I have to share this with you. I've gotten so many letters and so many wishes, and someone wrote just last week, "If you do anything that people don't like, just tell them that you love Peyton Manning." So I'm here today to tell you I love Peyton Manning, and I'm going to keep on loving Peyton Manning, and you can just clap all you want to for that. So thank you, Peyton. I loved you even before I came to the University of Tennessee. So every time I do something that people don't like, I'm just going to tell you I love Peyton Manning. UT alum and UT trustee Charlie Anderson worked with us, and we thank him. And UT alum and Cleveland Browns owner Jimmy Haslam, thank you so much. And of course, our vice chair, who works tirelessly in our for our board of trustees, and also a UT alum, Rajah Gibran. Thank you so very much for chairing this committee. So thank you to all of you for your work, for your recommendations, for your service. This really was a time and an effort and a common goal from the beginning to find the best person for Tennessee. And we believe, we truly believe, we found someone who meets all of those criteria that we were looking for. And that person is John Curry. I want to say a few things about John Curry. You see, he's so eager, he's ready to go right now. When I first talked to John Curry, we had an instant connection. And I asked him a lot of questions, and he can keep right up with me, and I talk pretty fast. My first impression, he's honest, he's transparent, he's high energy, he's pretty intense. He has a strong history with the University of Tennessee and Tennessee athletics. He's worked in some tough situations. We talked about the tough situations we had both faced, and he thrived in that role. And I asked him, how strong are you? How much courage do you have? You have a stiff backbone? He does. He's not afraid of a challenge. He's a man who possesses strong leadership skills. So I flew out to Manhattan, Kansas. And I met his family. I sat down at the kitchen table. They are here. Where are they? Let's see. Right over here. And Mary Lawrence, thank you so much. We sat at the kitchen table. And Mary Dell and Virginia, you're here with them. You all had gone off to school, as you certainly should have. And your brother Jack, and I'm sorry he couldn't be here. And I loved your family, but I'm sorry, John, I think it was your mother who really put you over the goal line. His sweet mother, who just hugged me the minute I walked in the door and made me feel so comfortable. And so I'll let you all laugh at me one more time. John picks me up at the airport, and he had in his front seat the state of Tennessee, and what does it say? I will give my all for Tennessee today. I said, funny, John. Did you happen to see my tweet? So today and always, we are going to give our all for Tennessee, and I love that, John, and I loved his sense of humor. He served me out of a Tennessee glass. He had orange all over his house. I said, wow, here's a guy who loves Tennessee. It was a great meeting, and it reassured me we had found the right person. We had found the right person to lead this department into the future. So John, Mary Lawrence, your three children, who all were born right here in Knoxville, no question about it, they're Tennesseans. I look forward to working with you. I look forward to success. I look forward to championships. I look forward to one UT. Please join me in welcoming the next athletic director and vice chancellor, John Curry. And are we, and is our athletic department quick or what? Here you go, John Curry, number one.
Well, good afternoon, and thank you so much, Chancellor Davenport, for that wonderful introduction. This is an unbelievable day for the Curry family. This morning, when I walked into the building, Rita handed me a letter from Dr. Johnson welcoming me here. And to think that I'm standing right here basically in the same place that he handed me my diploma 15 years ago is pretty cool. Dr. Davenport called me on Monday afternoon, and we had a great conversation. Of course, I already knew about her vision, her reputation for vision and energy, and her strong leadership. We all know how incredibly complex a chancellor's position is, and for her to drop everything just a week into her job, to fly out to Manhattan, Kansas, shows me that she gets it and that she is committed to the Tennessee athletics program achieving at the highest level. We had a fantastic visit in our kitchen, as she mentioned, with my wife, Mary Lawrence, and it's kind of that millennial thing. My mom was there too, but not for the whole conversation, but she was there. And the chancellor pulled out that piece of paper after a few hours, and all I could think about was maxim number two, Mr. Haslam. Play for and make the breaks, and when one comes your way, score. So I pulled out that pen and signed that piece of paper real fast. Thank you, Chancellor, for your trust in me. I'm also honored to be here with Dr. DiPietro. As an alumnus, I'm proud of the tremendous growth across the system under his leadership. The Chancellor mentioned Dave Hart, and late Tuesday afternoon, I had a wonderful conversation with Dave Hart. Throughout my 24 years in college athletics, he's been someone I've followed and looked up to. I'm grateful for his hard work for Tennessee, and he was down with our women's basketball team today in Greenville. Being here in this building and this spot brings back so many special memories, like my first third Saturday in October, when Coach Fulmer led us to victory in Legion Field, extending our streak in that great rivalry. One of the many magical moments in that decade of dominance, as Coach Fulmer gave us the greatest run in the modern era of Tennessee football. I remember watching those Lady Vol banners go up, and when we named this court in honor of the greatest basketball coach of all, Pat Summitt. And Coach Barnes, I apologize, but I remember when Chris Lofton hit that 35-footer over Coach Kevin Durant back in 07 or 06 or whatever it is. And I'm glad you're here on our side now. And after you beat my team a couple weeks ago, I'm glad I'm on your side. Talking to Karen and Ralph Weekly this morning brings back memories of Monica Abbott, mowing them down. And of course, there's so many classic moments of high athletic achievement across the Tennessee history. You know, Coach Dickey always used to tell us, and Joan Cronin and I, we always talk about Coach Dickey and what we learned from him. And I learned so much from Joan about how to treat people. And she's been such a great mentor and continued fan to me over the last 8 years. But Coach Dickey used to tell us, we're either playing for the title or we're biting on the butt of the guy that is, right? And we talk about those great moments athletically and academically. I get so excited knowing that the University of Tennessee can and should be the very best athletics program in the country. Now, as you've already heard, I carried General Nealon's seven maxims with me when I left in 2009. And for the past 8 years, I've been blessed to work in support of Coach Bill Snyder, who joined Coach Fulmer and Coach Battle and Coach Dickey and Coach Wyatt and Coach Majors and General Nealon in the College Football Hall of Fame last year. Now, Coach Snyder's built his program around 16 goals. And my two favorites, which I talk about all the time in my letters and my conversations with the folks out there, my two favorite goals is goal number 12, no self-limitations, and goal number 3, unity. I can't wait to get started. And as the Chancellor said, nothing is more special to my beautiful wife, Mary Lawrence, than Jack, who's trying out for baseball right now, he couldn't miss that, and Virginia and Mary Dell were all born right here on Rocky Top. Thank you from the bottom of our hearts for bringing us right back to where we come from. Go Vols.
We're going to take a moment to kind of go through this process and how it happened, how quickly it happened. Dr. Davenport, you've hit the ground running since you've been here. So talk about the transition and what it's been like for you the last 10 days.
Okay, 10 days. I don't know if I remember every one of those days. I don't think I've slept very much. Okay, I hit the ground running. I think I had a meeting with my senior leadership team. I think I did that. Let me see. I was welcomed. We had a welcoming from the faculty, from the students, from the staff. Thank you all so much. Joe just kept saying, come on, you're doing great. We've been to Nashville. We had a day on the Hill. We told them how great the University of Tennessee is. We've been involved in nuclear security. We do great things here. I've been telling everybody we're the 46th top public university in the country. I've gotten all my facts. I was welcomed by the city of Knoxville. Thank you all so much. I bought a house 3 days ago. I haven't even been in it yet. I have flown around the country 2 or 3 times. I've talked to my children a couple of times. All my family's in Nashville. They're texting me like crazy. I flew out to Manhattan, Kansas. I met his great family. That's about 10 days worth. How
that's
about that?
That's pretty good. That's not bad. Not bad.
I probably forgot a few
things. I'm glad we're not paying you overtime. That's pretty good.
Well, you can talk to my boss about that.
Okay.
Talk to Rajah. He'll talk to you about that pay.
John, you did a great job in Kansas. When you went there, when you left Tennessee, they were in bad shape financially. Their facilities behind. You've got them caught back up in all those areas. So why leave Kansas State? Why come back here?
Well, I talked a little bit about it already, Bob, but I would say that I have to thank the people at Kansas State in Manhattan, Kansas, and they got something that's in common with the people of Tennessee and in Knoxville, and that is incredible passion, right? And we'd always rather have passion, regardless of whether it's up or down that day, than apathy and people that don't care. And it's been an incredible ride to work with Bill Snyder, to do $210 million of athletic facility construction without any state dollars or university dollars or and not very much debt as well has been cool. But I am so appreciative of Dr. Kirk Schultz, who hired me there 8 years ago from here. He took a chance on a guy that had never been an athletics director. But I would say that being in this room, there's so many people here that raised me, right? And when you're raising a kid, you know, sometimes it gets a little out of line. You got to knock them back into place. And the people here help prepare me to be successful there. I believe the people there have helped prepare me to be successful here. And I just ask for everyone, I'm just like any other player, keep coaching me up.
John, anytime there's a change in leadership, there's parts of the fan base that are fractured or part of the universe, how do you pull everybody back together right now? Is that one of your biggest jobs early?
Well, again, like I said earlier, the one thing we don't have to worry about at the University of Tennessee, which as you look around the country, there are a bunch of college programs that they've got this problem, that people don't care, right? I'll take care anytime, right? We can deal with care, and we're going to get right after it. We're going to be all around, across the state and around the country. We're going to be across campus. One of the things that is really, really important is that the academic reputation of a university is critical in driving the athletic success of the university, right? And we talked about that a lot at K-State over the last 7 or 8 years as we went through the conference realignment deal, right? And so if we are an elite academic university, that will help us from an athletic standpoint, and I'm gonna work really hard to get across our campus and represent our coaches and student athletes with our deans and our department heads, et cetera, and be a person in support of the chancellor.
Chancellor, you did have a search firm and a search committee. Talk about their role in all of this and how important a part they played in finally getting us to John Curry.
They've been essential. I mean, these are people, they do this every day, all day long, 7 days a week. I was on the phone, in text, and I can't compliment enough Turnkey. They would update me with who they had talked to, who they have feedback on, who had told them about people, who was available. They were essential. Then, of course, they worked very closely with our search committee, and the search committee's job was to make recommendations. So they were working all the time, and they were essential.
What led you to John Curry? What were the things that attracted you to
what led me to John Curry? Well, the search committee led me to John Curry. Everybody around the country's been talking about John Curry. I heard about John Curry before I ever came to the University of Tennessee. Surprisingly, it's not just the state of Tennessee who knows about John Curry. I have been getting texts and emails for, I think, since I took off from the runway. Wow, you got the guy. And he's a known commodity, so it was not a surprise that the Turnkey knew about him and took him to our search committee.
John, while you were at Kansas State, you were out there looking at the SEC, trying to figure out how you compete with the SEC and beat the SEC. Did it give you more of an appreciation of how strong this conference really is and how tough it is to win in this league?
It is tough to win in this league now, and I was proud of my team, you know, winning, or my old team, I should say, beating Texas A&M, and we want to continue that kind of stuff. But one of the cool things about this for me is I know so many folks in this league, and Greg Sankey, the SEC commissioner, has been a longtime friend and a mentor of mine. And I got a couple buddies, right, that have taken over programs that we like to compete with. My boy Greg Byrne in Alabama, and Scott Strickland down at Florida, right? And those are two of my closest friends that have taken over down there this year. And I can't wait to beat those guys.
That's good. John, you were around when all the building was going on here at Tennessee, the Thornton Center, the Pratt Pavilion, Larry Pratt's here today, the football renovation at Neyland Stadium. So you know exactly, probably an inside track on what this place needs, where you're going, and how fast you want to get there.
Well, we are so blessed at the University of Tennessee, and I look out here and I see Mr. and Mrs. Haslam, and I see Larry Pratt, and I see Brenda Lawson, and so many other folks, and I'm not supposed to start because I can't ever stop. You know, I'm going to name everybody in this room that helped us catch back up a number of years ago. But this deal in college athletics, right, is no different than the rest of the university. As I walk across, as I came here a month or so ago with the Wildcats and saw the different stuff that's been built, the beautiful new College of Business, the Tickle Engineering School. I mean, we got to get better in every area of our university. That's your responsibility. My responsibility is athletics.
It's both of our responsibilities.
Both of our responsibilities. I'm going to help that too. But the thing we can't do is we can't stop. We can't ever think we're done. We got to keep going every single day. You know, coaches know that because everybody else is going at it too. Everybody else is getting up at 5:30 in the morning or whatever it is you're allowed to do now. 6 a.m., I guess. You're not supposed to have any stuff before 6 a.m. anymore. Everybody else is getting up then too. So we've got to have great facilities just like we got to have great laboratories. And one of the really cool things about this is that, for me, is that back in 2003 or 2004, the Board of Trustees authorized us to start a master plan for renovations to Neyland Stadium. And when we started that thing, we knew that that was a massive undertaking to get that incredible landmark of the great game of college football up to par and then ready, because in 2021, that's our centennial for Neyland Stadium, right? And we started that thing back in 3 and 4 and 5, thinking about it was going to take a while to get there. We got to get it done and ready for its next century by 2021, right? And so much has already been done there, and I know there's some more things in the pipeline. I'm really, really flattered and honored that I get to come back and help finish what I was a small part of help starting 10 or 15 years ago.
Well, we're glad you're back. John's got a press conference he has to get to now. Let's thank Dr. Davenport for hard work, and let's welcome John Curry back to Tennessee. Thank you so much for being here today, and go Vols. We'll be right back.
Service is first. It's first. You were a vampire. I Check 1-2, quick mic check. 1-2, test 1-2. Check 1-2-3-4-5-6-7-8. Check 1-2-3-4-5-6-7-8-9-10. 1-2, you guys good? Check 1-2-1-2, test 1-2-3. Check 1-2.
They might have a brief statement here.
What do y'all think? I have long legs or something? Where am I going? You going here?
Make contact with MJ and Steven, and we'll call on you.
All right. You know these people?
I know them.
Good.
Would you like the Chancellor to begin, Ryan? Yes. Chancellor?
Well, good afternoon. How are you all?
Good, thank you.
All right, great. Well, I'm great too, and I'm happy to be here, and I think I've already had my opening statement, so I'm just delighted to see all of you out here today, and I couldn't be happier to introduce John Curry. So I think I'm open for questions, and if you want to have any opening comments, you're just welcome to do that, but we're here to answer any questions you have and tell you what we've been up to for the last few days.
And I would just add, again, as I said out front, I'm incredibly grateful to the people of Tennessee and to the Chancellor for giving our family this opportunity. You know, I remember when this room was with cinder block walls, and to see it now as it's come along through the years is pretty special. The only other thing, I was a little bit disappointed that, you know, the plane got in this morning, and I had briefed my beautiful wife and the girls to be ready. You know, there was going to be some people there and stuff like that. And not only were none of y'all there, but there was nobody there. So I thought it was maybe a Johnny Knoxville practical joke, and I was not really the athletic director. So it's good to see you all here.
That's okay. They didn't meet me either.
This is for both you guys. Coach Jones always talks about that in-home visit. You talked about that up on stage. Can you take us a little bit more through that? Kind of food did you serve? Any kind of those details?
Yeah, John, tell them about all that good food you gave me. Let me take that one.
You're the Chancellor.
All right, you heard me tell you he picked me up. He had that great sign in his car. Did you hear? You were out there, right? Right. So we got to his house, and he did ask me if I'd like any coffee, if I'd like anything to drink. And I said, well, I'd love some water. And he pulled out a Tennessee glass, a big power tea on the glass. I said, oh, my. He had orange in his house. I think he has more Tennessee things than I do. So he pulled it all out. We didn't eat. I think John talks more than I do, and that's a lot. So we went right to work. I was asking him questions. He was asking me questions. We worked. It was a working meeting. We didn't eat. We talked. But I did have water out of a power tea glass. So there you go. That's what we had. He probably drank coffee because he drinks coffee. I don't drink coffee. No food, just work and water.
Chancellor Davenport,
yes.
Can you talk a little bit about how this worked with the search committee? It sounded out there as if they did not interview John through the process. It was just you and in the in-home visit. How did it work with the search committee in terms of their interviews with him? Did they vote? Was it straight recommendation for you? How did the relationship with you and the search committee go to reach the final decision?
Well, I think it was just as I described it out front. Turnkey worked with us and for us, and Turnkey looked for candidates for us throughout the entire process, and they had been working with us. They took candidates to our search committee. Our search committee brought candidates to me, and that's how it worked. You know, to protect all the people in this process, and you all saw me going through my search.
The committee did not interview candidates. You were the only one to interview.
No, that's not what I said. The search committee met with candidates. Search committees talked with candidates. This has been a long process. But to protect the privacy of the people in the search, this is how it worked. I went out to see him. But the search committee recommended to me John, and that's why I went to John.
John, you obviously talked out there a lot about some of the memories you had from your first time here. I guess, how have your 8 years, however long it's been since you've been at Kansas State, how that maybe changed you as a person and kind of prepared you for this job?
Well, I think all of us, and especially I hope us people in higher education, you know, we should always be learning. And going out to Kansas State, when we got there, President Schultz and I, and one person I want to recognize that was integral in that process was Amy Button-Rentz, who chaired the search that hired me out there. She's the Alumni Association Director there and continues to be an incredible friend. And I also want to recognize General Richard Myers, who's the new president at Kansas State University, former chairman of Joint Chiefs of Staff. So when we got there, we had some major problems. Y'all can go back and read. We had some major facility deficiencies. We had financial irregularities. We had lawsuits. We had secret contracts. We had, you know, just one thing after another. And we had low confidence. We were projecting a budget deficit for the next year. And one of the things we did in that process, President Schultz, under his leadership, is we just got out there with our fans and with the K-State Nation, so to speak. And there's some similarities, you know. Tennessee has a big orange caravan, and K-State's got the Cat-Backer Tour, so we got out and about and really worked hard, and we had to re-earn trust. And part of the way that we worked hard, and I worked hard to re-earn trust with our constituents, being very transparent, being very accessible. And so we'll do some things here over the next little bit from an athletics perspective to ensure that the Tennessee faithful and the whole Tennessee family feel like they have the good opportunity to connect and share their passion and feelings.
John, not saying that you were looking to leave out there, but in your mind, was it a goal ever to get back here? Was it something you thought about? And as you go into this job, second part, just what's priority number one for you?
Well, let me start with priority number one. I mean, your second part of your question, which was priority number one, right? And then I'll come back to kind of career goals and kind of how things move along. My first priority is that, you know, I know a lot of folks around here, but there's a lot of folks I don't know or I knew just a little bit a long time ago. There's a lot of new folks and new buildings and incredible growth in Knoxville. So my first thing I got to do is, you know, the Lord gave me two ears and two eyes and one mouth for a reason. I got to get around and listen and see and learn and reconnect with folks. And I can't wait to start doing that. The opportunity to go to Kansas State University 8 years ago was really, really special. And, you know, to have a president take a chance on a person who'd never been a sitting AD before, I think is a reflection of the University of Tennessee and what people like Doug Dickey and Joan Cronin and Philip Fulmer and Pat Summitt and Bud Ford and Carmen Nagano and lots of different people, Condridge Holloway throughout the Tennessee family and certainly all the folks that are in the back of the room, how well they prepared me. So being at K-State, you know, one thing that Coach Dickey said one time, and actually, I guess it's General Patton or something like that, you know, once you make a decision, you know, you pour everything into making that the right decision. So when I went to K-State, I was poured into K-State. And even though because of our success there, you know, primarily because of our coaches and student athletes, and we were able to build a few buildings and raise a little money and all that kind of stuff, you know, there were lots of times when all these different search firms or people would call pretty quickly within the first couple of years. But I really felt like I was completely embedded, and so you know, when this opportunity came along, when Dave Hart announced he was going to retire last summer, you know, of course I thought about, boy, that would be really, really, really special to go back to Rocky Top. But in our business, and our coaches know this, if you're not completely focused on where you are every single day, you'll fail real fast. And so I've always been really focused on that, and I'm grateful to Gene DeFilippo, who's got a Tennessee degree, who's been a mentor to me through the years, and Lynn Perna for reaching out to me. I'm grateful for that, and I couldn't be happier than to sit right here. Did you hear me out there?
Did you hear me out there?
Well, I mean, that's what we got a bunch of banners around here. We got trophies. Like Coach Dick used to say, you're either biting on the butt of the guy that's playing for the title, or you're either playing for the title or biting on the butt of the guy that is. And that's what Tennessee is about. Now, you know, we didn't talk a lot out there about academic integrity in the once-in-a-lifetime, completely unique American animal that is the intercollegiate athletics opportunity that is so special and gets better every single year, that opportunity. You know, that's really why we're here. And so one of the things that's happened in college athletics over the last, especially after over the last 5 or 6 years, as this conference realignment stuff has happened and the television money has exploded, is there's not nearly enough talk about the young people that wear our uniforms and compete. And Tennessee's got outstanding history of academic excellence. People like Kara Lawson, and of course Peyton Manning, and lots of others. I was there when Michael Munoz was named as the Campbell Trophy winner in New York a number of years ago. We want to do all that stuff. We want to represent at the highest level academically. But we don't have 100,000 seats and 21,000 seats and a beautiful baseball stadium and Allen Jones Intercollegiate Aquatic Center. We don't have all that stuff just for intramurals, right? We got that stuff because we should be representing intercollegiate athletics at the highest level and winning championships. That's absolutely critical. And you know, Joan and Coach Dickey, all of us, Donna Thomas, you do exit interviews with student athletes, right? After their time is through, to learn what you can learn about how to make their student athlete experience better. I've yet to have a student athlete who didn't tell me that winning was a great part of their college experience.
John, you had mentioned some of the female athletes here, and obviously a passionate issue with a lot of them was when the Lady Vols was taken away. Would you ever, is there any interest in readdressing that at any point, or have you even got to that stage of thinking about that possibility?
The quick answer to that is that I've been in this deal for about 70 hours and hadn't started to think about much of anything. I'm not even sure I locked the car at the airport. But I do passionately believe in how the University of Tennessee under Joan and others has been, you know, set the example for intercollegiate athletics through the years. One of the things I'm really proud about at Kansas State University is that, we have a rowing program here at Tennessee, and when I got to K-State, our rowing program at K-State, or their rowing program, they had no facility. The wind blows out in Kansas, so sometimes in January it's hard to get on that lake, and they were doing their practice rowing in this old fire trap of an old dance studio in an old building, Ahern Fieldhouse, which is kind of like the old Stokely Fieldhouse. And it's amazing that the fire marshal never came in there. But, you know, 4 years later, we opened a brand new $3.2 million intercollegiate rowing facility for those 80 student athletes. So I'm really proud of the fact that that $210 million of athletic facility improvements at Kansas State included benefits for all sports, both men's and women's sports there.
John, over here, you've talked about this a little bit, things to continue in your education out there. How are you a different person, different athletic director now than when you left here?
Sure, Mike. Mary Lawrence and I have been married 18 years, or almost 18 years, right, honey? June 27th, right, honey? Right? 1997, is that 18 years? Or got to be 19 years? I can't remember. Nevertheless, I think she would say that in our marriage, I've probably evolved, right? Or else she'd be married to somebody else, right? And I think we all evolve in our lives. And you know, I remember Coach Dickey one time when I first got here saying, "Now, John, the wheels aren't off this thing. You don't have to go fix everything yet, right?" And so I think, as you know, especially as a young person, all of us, you know, we start off thinking we got to solve every problem right now in a certain way. And over time, you kind of learn that you sometimes need to sit back a little bit, and Bud Ford needs to get in your face a little bit and tell you why you're wrong and stuff like that. And you know what? A lot of times you learn and adapt from that.
Just. There are some factions in the fan base. Some people wanted one guy to get this job, some people another. How do you go about kind of bringing all the factions together? And also, I just want to double check. Is your birthday the first day, April 1st, the first day you take office? I'm just making sure that is correct.
That is correct. My birthday is April 1st. I'll be 46 years old. My children, Virginia's birthday is April the 3rd. Mary Dell was born on January 13th, and Jack was born on March the 17th. So all my children, they all talk about when they joined the Dad Missed My Birthday Club, you know, because you're at the Final Four or whatever it is. And so they're talking about that already on April 1st, but it's a Saturday, so we're going to try to maybe FaceTime the birthday or something like that. And what was the question?
United.
You know, all I can do is get out there and work hard every single day. And I think the listening part and recognizing the heritage that all the people represent, you know, this is a very special place, and people have poured their heart and soul into the place. You just got to spend some time and appropriately honor, recognize, and be around, and those things will work out.
John, you've referenced a bunch of names in the past. Obviously, you have a history here. You understand what you're getting into. Piggybacking off that question, how much can that help ease the transition, solidify, draw it together, and then from a stability standpoint, this being, I'm going to assume, a dream job, destination job for you, how important do you think that is for the stability of athletics?
Well, I've been really blessed, Brent. You know, I've been in three places. And so many college ADs or presidents or chancellors or assistant coaches or whatever, you know, have to go so many times. And I've really been in three, and I get to come back to one of the ones I've already been at. And, that's an advantage and a disadvantage. One of the disadvantages is that, you know, when you're at a place for a while and you're part of decisions and stuff like that, you do hurt some feelings or whatever. But there's also the advantage, right, of that you know a lot of folks too. And so I think that, my two good buddies that took Greg and Scott that took the Alabama-Florida job, you know, that they've never been at those places, so they got a learning curve. I've got a learning curve, and I've also got a reacquaintance curve, and I'm going to get after it.
Chancellor Davenport, when Coach Curry and his team weren't in town for the basketball game, were you able to meet with him any at all that weekend? Did you all visit face-to-face that weekend of the basketball game? And I can't remember, is it going to be a five-year deal for Mr. Curry?
I did not meet with John when he was here. You'll see all the details about the contract.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
All right.